Well, I've had the chance to go to four different villages, Native villages, and I'll talk about it a little bit, how that all happened. But I'm just amazed how people are living there. I mean, they're living well, but they're living like they have years and years ago, and there's not much change. This is kind of the most authentic dress that I've seen, and they dress differently in the different villages. But I look at this, and I notice, you know, all the things here, and a dugout canoe with duct tape. Well, now, actually, I don't think that's duct tape. I think it's metal, but it's pretty something from the modern world, so it's a blend between the old and the new. I'm going to talk about, like, four different areas, and one, I'm going to give you a little background on the how the people got to the Americas and their history. It's going to be very brief, but I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Then I'll talk about the three villages that I went to. And the first one is a Tropic Star Lodge, excellent fishing lodge, one of the best in the world, and I was lucky to get down to see that. I didn't have any idea that I was going to see natives there. I mean, I just go to lodges, and they're usually next to town. We go out in a boat. But this one isn't. This is in a remote area, and I'll show you later where it is. And if you notice here, these people, they don't look like natives. They aren't dressed like the people in the previous slide. They're pretty acclimated. They work at the lodge. They're pretty acclimated to the Western life. Then I went to a village that nobody goes to. It happened to be the village where the captain lives, and it looks like a paradise, doesn't it? It's on the beach, and it looks like a tropical paradise. And the third village I went to was on a Panama Canal cruise. And probably some of you have been to this same village. Have some of you been to these villages on the Princess or Panama Canal cruises? One, yeah. So, and this seemed to be the most authentic dress, at least the way they used to dress. Well, how did the people get here? There was a land bridge across Alaska and Asia, Russia, during the years 28,000 to 9,000 BC, so a long time, 19,000 years. So it was there for a long time. During the time, the ocean level was down as much as 140 feet, lower than what it is today. It was all in ice on the land. And so there was it just got down slow that there was just this natural bridge. There was just land between Russia. So during that time, about 14,000 BC, 16,000 years ago, there was a migration that people walked across that land bridge and came across. There's been some debate, well, was it one mass of people, one group of people? Was it three or four waves of people? But I think the latest is it was probably one mass of people, one group of people that came across to populate the Americas. If we compare that age back to where the Great Pyramids were built, this is about 4,500 years ago, 4,600 years ago, and that's 16,000. So that was three times as far back as when the pyramids were being built. What was the population of America's total North and South America in 1491? What would you think?
100,000.
A few million.
50,000.
5 million.
Sold.
Well, according to Charles Mann, who wrote the book, and he was describing the Americas before Columbus got here, it was 100 million people. Now, there are other estimates, and most of them are lower. This is a fairly high estimate. But it was a fully populated land. It wasn't that, hey, there's a lot of vacant area there. Certainly there was, but some of it wasn't suitable for habitation and so on. But it was basically a fully populated land. I want to talk about the Mayans and the Aztecs and how power developed during that era. First of the Olmecs, and they were started about 1200 BC. The Mayans really lasted a long time, from about 1000 BC to 1500 AD, so like 2500 years. And the Toltecs had a smaller history that we can trace, and the Aztecs then were dominant in Central America for 300 years or so. They probably or may have come from the southwest United States, but it was the same kind of group of people. The Mayan area is here, and so it's this region, the colored region. There were more than 100 villages. I went to see Tulum, which is right here, and that one, because it was so easy to get to, you could go in a Princess Cruise, and that's one of the day excursions. So it was a great way to go see the village. One of the main villages, there's Tikal right there, and that was the capital of the Mayan Empire for a long time. It switched back and forth. There was another village, just read in National Geographic. There was another village that took power part of the time. Way up in here is Mexico City, where the Aztecs were, so they're not in the same area. The temple is over here, and that just beyond that is right on the shore of the Pacific or the Caribbean Ocean, Caribbean Sea. And then all these other buildings are whatever, storage, living, whatever they are. And it has a wall around it. It is a, they are, were skirmishing, warring, whatever, and so they have self-protection. But the Mayans were builders and scientists. They had many gods that regulated their lives, more than 100. They had a god for everything, for rain, for crops, for war, for everything. They had a hierarchy of gods. Some were more important than others. They were able to predict eclipses accurate to one day in 6,000 years. They abandoned their dense populations in the year 8th to 12th century. And that's consistent with some droughts that were in the area at that time. And so they had to feed their people, and maybe they weren't able to feed their people in these dense populations they had. But there's still about 6,000 Mayan-speaking people in the world today. This is Tikal from the air. I want to talk a little about it. It's in Guatemala. It's very near the Mexican and Belize border, and people can go to it. They have tours to Tikal. It was a city of about 100,000. Now stop and think about that. If you get a city of 100,000, and they had a density, population density similar to what is in Los Angeles today. So there were a lot of people, and they had to feed these people. So they had ways of feeding those people. It began about 4,000 BC, was abandoned about 1,400 years later, or 400 BC. And then it was rediscovered in 1848 because it was overgrown and people were able to find it. It's like 2-day hike from the nearest road, but now there's an airstrip close by, and so people can go in pretty easily and see it. We talk a little about the Mayan heritage. The stone face over here is about 10 feet tall. It was done by the original people, the Olmecs, even before the Mayans. But what I was interested here, this young lady at a market in Puerto Quetzal in Guatemala, if I look at her face shape and this shape, I say, yeah, it's the same. The language is very interesting. Anytime they did something, they would write it down in these, and this is called a stela, so they'd write on the front and the back of this, and this would be about a battle that they won, or the history of a ruler. This one is Rabbit 14. I have no idea why it's named Rabbit 14, but that's what is the ruler. They have a complete language. It's syllable by syllable. It's about 800 characters long compared to our 26. For a long time, the language was lost. Let me go a little farther here. I'm going to skip over to this. They were the only American natives that could write everything that they could say. So it was a complete language. The Catholic priests, when they came in, burned their books. They required the scribes to write in Spanish rather than the Mayan language. And so the language was lost. I think there are like three books that have survived. So they did a thorough job. And so they lost the ability to read the language, the hieroglyphs, but they could always speak the language. So this is kind of what it looks like. They read it top to left to from top to bottom, left to right. And so each one of those is a syllable. You can see it took a lot of work to write something in that language. And there's a lot of written, and now we know a lot about it because there's a lot of records of what was going on during the time. What civilization was the most advanced in 800 AD? Now you'd certainly think, well, the Europeans or the Chinese or whatever. And that might very well be true, but there are scientists that argue that the Mayans were the most advanced, or at least competing as one of the most advanced civilizations. So let's go to the Aztecs. This is around Mexico City. Both the Aztecs and the Mayans thought they had to make blood sacrifices to the gods. The rulers and the Mayans would cut themselves to provide blood for the rulers. But in the Aztecs, they really got it to a deal where there were lots and lots of sacrifices. A ruler had to have a lot of sacrifices to have, and a new ruler particularly, to have a good inauguration. Fortunately, we don't do that now. And they're talking about thousands, you know, maybe 10,000 sacrifices. And the way they got those sacrifices was to go to war and capture people and bring them in and sacrifice them. If the person had a skill that was valuable to them, they would spare that person and would basically make him a slave. They had well-planned battles, and they used bow and arrows, swords, and shields. Now, the sword, you can see over here, was a wooden sword inlaid with obsidian. It was sharper than the metal swords that the Europeans were bringing over. And then you can see that these are their shields. And of course, this is a dance on one of the cruise ships, so it's, you know, it's a depiction of what's going on. I was interested in the headsets, too. That's a jaguar and that's an eagle. Looks like gold, but obviously it's not in this case. It's no doubt plastic, gold color. So the native people today. This is a uncontacted native group in Brazil. The picture was in 2008. They're in long huts, and that's typical the way they live in Brazil. And you can see there's some warriors there. You can see what they think of the helicopter or whatever it is that's flying overhead. How many tribes in Brazil do not have contact with the outside world?
We can't count because we haven't contacted them.
Well, but we fly over them, you know, so we know the areas. And I don't know that we know all of them, but we know a lot. Well, the number is like 67. It so amazes me that the number is that high. New Guinea has a lot. Peru has quite a few. So there are quite a few that do not have contact with the outside world. Yeah. There are a couple of tribes in Brazil that were not receptive to visitors. So some missionaries came in and they killed them. The government sent some people in. They killed them. And so they decided, well, maybe we really don't need to do this. The area that I'm going to talk about is the Darien jungle. This is Panama City. This is the east part of Panama, the southeast part of Panama. So it's Panama City. And then the first place I went was Penis Bay, right here. And I visited a tribe up in this area, up 25 miles north of that village. And I visited a tribe up off of the Panama Canal, up off of Catoon Lake. It's about 100 miles, more than 100 miles, about 100 miles between these two. And the Panama natives have a different history than the Aztecs and the Mayans. They didn't have any riches, so there was no real reason to go in and conquer them. And they lived in small tribes, so that if, and you know, on beaches or wherever they were, but somebody could come in and do whatever they want to. Well, these guys just melt into the jungle, and when the people left, they'd come back. So they were never conquered. So as a result, much of their way of life hasn't changed much over hundreds of years. They are small people. These are the first natives that I saw. I was asked to go to this fishing village. This is a wonderful fishing village. You catch blue marlin, really great fish there. So I was asked to go, invited to go to that village. And so the first thing I did, you know, you fly into Panama City, and then you get on a plane the next day to go out. We went to the airport, which is the local airport, and these are some of the natives I saw right away. And you kind of, okay, this is different. There's a couple of things you notice right away. Is they are a short people, and they have short legs. You can see this lady has, her legs are painted, like she's has socks, but they're painted on. They flew us in a twin otter, and they have a nice airport, you know, a nice runway there. You can see that there's a lot of overgrowth around it. There's a lot of jungle around it. It wouldn't take very long for that to reclaim the airport if they didn't keep it open. And as we got on, and the other group from the lodge got on to go back to Panama City. And right there at the airport, we saw something that looked pretty native, that something I hadn't seen before, was handcrafted dugout canoes. And you can see that in this one over here, that there are no seats, and that's pretty typical. People just sit on the bottom and paddle. This one has a seat. There are just three pieces of wood put together there. There's a boat up here that is a manufactured boat, so they have both. There are a couple of kids out in Penis Bay, and they're fishing. You see, this person is fishing. That's the way people in Central America mostly fish, is with something to wrap the line around. They just curl the line and send it out where they want it, and that's their natural way of fishing. So they're out there fishing, but I was noticing that this is the freeboard. I don't know that I'd want to be in a boat like that without any more freeboard than that. And they're in a bay, you know, it's an ocean bay, and it's pretty big. It could get windy, and it could come up there. Kids obviously learn early to deal with the water. They're around that, and they learn to deal with this sort of thing early. No life jackets either, you'll notice that, but they can probably swim like fish. And so this is the Tropic Star Lodge. It's a nice lodge. They it's out in the wilderness, but it's kind of a first-class place. In the 1960s, when it first opened, and it was a private lodge at that time, the people came to work this way. You can see loincloths, a shirt in some cases. The women came with no tops, sarongs. In 2008, the first time I went there, this is what they were like. They had t-shirts, caps, you know, they were dressing just like we were dressing. Back to the 1960s, one of the natives climbing a tree, and I want to show a little more detail on that, so I blew that up. And you can see he's got a lot of face painting, and of course a lot of body painting, wearing a loincloth. Up here he's got a knife, and there are steps in the tree as they go along. So they're all set, and he's either going up to get to harvest some coconuts, or maybe to get some prawns, which they use for their basket weaving. And I'll talk about that later. Now, the dye that they use for their markings on their body is a agua nut dye. The second time I was there, and I was interested in that, and I asked somebody, oh yeah, we'll bring you some tomorrow. So they brought some of this. And what it is, this is the nut. And you know, I grew up in the Midwest, so we had black walnuts. Did any of you have black walnuts? And you remember that we put those under the car to crush the skins on them, and then dig out the walnut, and your fingers were just black when you got done with that. Well, this is much the same thing. And so it's the husk of the nut and the center of the nut, and they apparently boil it with some water to the right consistency, and that's it. they offered that to me to take home, and I don't have any use for it. And one of the ladies says, oh, my teenage daughter would like to have that, so she took it home. And it does last for, they say, 2 weeks, but maybe 6 weeks. So you don't have to replenish it every day or anything like that. We went to the village at Pinus Bay, and I noticed this knife that this young guy was carrying. And that's probably all right. You know, they're pretty, they learn early how to deal with things. The other thing that I noticed is there's a bottle here. It looks like a vodka bottle to me. And these people have jobs at the lodge, and they have money. Maybe not a lot, but they have enough to buy booze and things like that. And so that's not always a good thing. Of course, you can probably say that about any society, that there are people that abuse them. And they grow crops, and they grow animals. They grow pigs. They're one of the things they grow. So here's a young guy with a pig, and somebody told me that if he's down in the village, he's probably, they're getting ready for a festival. There's going to be a barbecue before long. So, yeah. And I was surprised that it's a village of 700 people, and look what they have, a medical clinic. Now, I don't think it's manned all the time, but it's pretty typical of all these villages that I went to that the doctors come out maybe once a month, the kids get their shots, their vaccinations, and so they're modern in that way. And they brought some teenage sort of people, I thought, come in to dance for us. You can see they're wearing sarongs and some sort of bead top, and some maybe not the bead top, some of them aren't, but they just have no compunction about that. Just natural to them. One of the things they were doing is selling us their baskets, their woven ware, and some of their woodwork. Now you can see that this is pretty quality stuff. There's a turtle and there's a marlin and some beadwork. The baskets are not made with thread. They're made with the natural fiber from the frond leaf of the palm tree. And they have to have just the right palm tree, so they may have to go quite a distance to harvest that, but they will do that. One of the baskets that I looked at, and wow, that is really nice. And for these other baskets, you know, I wouldn't pay more than $10 for the basket or the dish, whatever it was, and that's fine. You could buy a lot for that. And this one, she priced at $20, and so I said, well, you take $15, and you know, you could bargain with them. But she just shook her head no. She didn't smile. She didn't do anything. Just no. So I gave her the $20 bill. You know, it was worth it. And if you look at the quality, you can see the front of this one is just perfect. Down here, you can see a few spots where, well, it didn't quite cover, but it's still darn good. But if you look at the back over here, it's still almost perfect, but you can see places like that. There's a little white showing on this one. Well, there's quite a bit of showing on the back. So just the quality of that one is so good. What's the most important employee at the lodge? Well, it's the skipper. You're the skippers. And, you know, and the crew. Because you come there, it costs probably $7,000 or $8,000 to go down there for 4 or 5 days. You've got to be able to catch fish, and those people are good. They're all natives. They're all the native people that are the skippers and the crew members. The crew members work with the captain for like 14 years, and they'll work with one captain for a season maybe, and then another captain and another captain. So they're learning all the ways to catch fish, and they're very good. Some of the best I've ever had. And they're doing a tug of war with this. And you know, we don't keep the fish. This is a black marlin, and the crew said it weighed about 450 pounds. And the crew members know, you know, if you go up to Alaska and they say, oh, that's a 100-pound halibut, it's pretty darn close to a 100-pound halibut. So I think that's probably pretty close. And the marlin get up to like 1,000-pound, and a 600-pounder is not too uncommon. It's, you know, it's not every day, but they're a big fish. At the end of that trip, the people come down and they come and stay for three or four or five days, whatever it is. And then they go back, but they'll come three or four times a year, some of them. Of course, a lot of people like me, that's a trip of a lifetime. But for some people, they just love that, and they come back again and again. So they get to know the people, and you'll notice that this person has a glove that was a gift from one of the visitors. There's a glove over here also, and then a box of baseballs. Now, baseball is an important sport in Central America. You know, we look at the rosters on our big leagues, and you'll see a lot of people, some from Panama, from all the South American countries. Well, one day we were fishing, and it wasn't very good, and we didn't have good bait. We used up all our good bait, and the skipper and I, we talked about this before, but the skipper asked us in Spanish or some way, made us know that he was willing to take us to his native village, which was about 25 miles north of there. And nobody comes here. You know, this is the way it really is. They didn't even know we're coming. I know this is authentic. So beautiful, beautiful place. You can see the fires in the back, and they're burning fields for crops. Well, a couple of the young people in the dugout canoes came. Now, they're pretty good rollers going in the beach here. And so they got through those all right. I didn't think I could. And the one was a skipper's son. I think this is the one that's the skipper's son. He had four sons. So I told him, go back and get the panga. Well, I was really surprised about they got a panga, but they came back with a panga. In the meantime, they got life jackets out for us, the three of us that were passengers. And the skipper and us went in, we put life jackets on. We put our cameras in plastic bags, and they got in the panga and took off. There are four people here. There's two right here, the second person there. And this person was also the skipper's son. He said he was a doctor. And I thought, okay, is he? What kind of doctor is he? And I'm not sure, but he may very well have been an educated doctor. We'll talk about that a little bit later. They brought us into where this river came in, and up into the inlet a little bit, and beached the boat, jumped out, pulled the boat up on the shore, and said, okay, you can get out now. You know, I mean, they didn't say that because we didn't understand their Spanish, and they didn't understand our English, but we could communicate a little bit. So we took the things out, took our cameras out, and jumped out of the panga. Went up on the beach. Now, so the ocean is just to the right of this, and this is what you see from the beach. So it's just a beautiful place, wonderful setting. And these are mostly, this one for sure, is a public facility. You know, it's for the tribe. It's not individual houses. So the individual houses look something like this. And you can see they're almost all made with fronds from the palm to shed the water. This one was our skipper's house. And you look at it and say, okay, it's still on stilts, but it's a full structure. It's an enclosed structure. Didn't have windows, but it had that, and it had a metal roof on it. Oh. Well, now, with the rain, I'm not sure that was an advantage, but I'm sure it was much more durable. Mm-hmm. We have the skipper and one of the passengers, the skipper here, we walked into the village, and we met the chief and walked around. And of course, they knew him, so there was no problem. We saw this lady and her daughter, apparently, I assume that's what it was. So I asked, you know, I always point the camera, can I take your picture? And if they say no, I won't. But they always say, pose for me, so I take a picture. Pretty soon the little girl climbed up the ladder. Now, the only type of ladder I've seen in any of these villages is just like this. It's notched log. Is there a ladder? There are some interesting things here that I didn't necessarily expect to see, but you can see thongs, you know, certainly a 5-gallon plastic pail. And back here, do you know what that is? Can you tell what that is? Lawnmower. And you think, well, they have gas for the outboard engine on the panga, so okay, they have a lawnmower. I'm not sure if they use it for some of their crops or if they just you know, you can see grass in the background here and other places you'll see grass. And are they just using that to keep the grass at a nice level? And what they don't have beds, you know, it's all hammocks. Sometimes they're hanging from the rafters in their living quarters, or sometimes they're hanging from underneath the floor. And you can, well, not on this one, but you can see the floor is usually a milled lumber and some things around the side. I think they just kind of build depending on how much lumber they have. Maybe it's driftwood that they've gotten, but they build to use whatever they have. I call this cooking with gas. And this was another surprise. That, so there's a propane bottle here. Looks like a gas cooktop to me. And then pans over here, and it looks like some shelves in here, maybe. So this is their kitchen, more or less. And, you know, what I'm telling you is what I'm surmising from a lot of this. Some of it's probably not right, but, you know, it kind of looks like, yeah, I think this makes sense.
You didn't climb up and go in.
Did not, no. And so, and they have some wood also, and they don't need to have wood for heating, so that's for cooking. And another house had a lot of wood under it, so they probably just cooked with wood. And they have coconuts, they have plantains, they have fish, you know. If monkeys come around into this area, they're in bad trouble because they like monkeys. So a lot of it is just what they can collect, and then there's some of it that they grow, including the pigs. And they have cassava, which is a root crop. They're famous in the Central America, not here, for their maize, their beans, or different things they have. And I call this workshop, and I was there, and in this village, most of the ladies were wearing tops. There were a few that weren't, but most of them were. Well, this is one that wasn't, and so I was taking pictures of that, and at the time I was kind of, oh, I don't want to get, they'd be embarrassed if I get up too close. They'd not be embarrassed at all. You know, I mean, this is the way they live. That's not a big deal. And I found that when I went to another village. So you can see that the clothes on the line, and there's a shovel there, various things. And it just looks to me like I'm calling that their wood shop, or where they were. I saw another couple, and I assume it's man and wife, but I don't know. And so he was out here, a nice smile, nice teeth. He's sitting on a hammock, and he's got his, this is his workbench, I think, and so he's got a piece of wood here that he's probably going to go to work and make something out of it, maybe a marlin or whatever it is. Oh, I'm not through there. And then I asked, motioned the girl, and she gave me this nice, shy smile, and she has something white on her hands, and I can think of two things that it might be, but I think it's coconut flakes. I think she was working on a coconut, but it could have been cassava, but I really think it was coconut flakes that was on her hands. So while we were there, these couple of kids came out and they started throwing the baseball back and forth. So even here, baseball is important to them. I wasn't sure if he was just showing off for us, or if that's what they do every afternoon. So this is the other end of that, and if you notice the glove, that's a nice glove. It's a little big for him maybe, but it's a quality glove. They had a school, and it was concrete block construction, no windows. That was their ventilation. The door was locked, they couldn't get in, and they go to school up to sixth grade in the local school, and then if they want to go on, they have to go into a boarding school in probably Panama City. And they do that. The government provides that for them so that they do that. And, you know, I don't mean that all of them do it, but that's certainly an option. And that's why I say that this doctor, he could have been a university, educated doctor. Maybe it was a four-year degree or something, not as much as we would have. I just don't know. And this is the inside of the classroom, and I can kind of relate to that. I mean, that's kind of a little bit the way our classrooms looked when I was going to school. So it was time to go. So we got back. We put our life jackets back on, put our cameras in the bag, got in the panga. Now we had breakers we had to get through. So they put a person, at one in the front and one in each corner, and then one in the boat. And so they'd push it out a ways, and the boat would go up about 45 degrees and get splashed with water and get through that breaker and then get a little farther out. And got through the second breaker, and about that time, they jumped in the, I don't know what he said actually, but everybody jumped in the boat. And then he started the engine, and away we went, another couple, up and down, and then from then on, it was smooth going.
Wow.
So we got them back there, we said, gosh, these people have been wonderful to us, what can we give them? Well, I had a few bucks, and I gave them everything I had with me, but that wasn't much. And we had lunches, and they always had lots of lunches, so we gave them our extra lunch. We gave them sodas. And one of them yelled, Coke, he knew what he wanted, so they know that. And so the third village that I went to is an Mbara village, just like the other two. They were all Mbara villages. There are about 20,000 in the Mbara nation there, and there's another tribes that are very similar, the Wunam. There's about 3,000 of those. So this is by bus and dugout canoe to this one. So it was from the ship. We went about an hour and a half on a bus, and then another 50 minutes in the dugout canoes.
Wow.
So it was very remote. We got to greet us. Of course, Panama or Princess Cruz pays these people to do this. And we were told that they tell the people, be just like you were, dress like you normally do, don't make any changes for our people. I'm not sure if they did or didn't, because these really look like natives. The only thing I saw no shorts at this one. It was all sarongs or the loincloths for the men. And though so the huts are the raised huts, just like in the other place. They raise the huts to get above. They say talk about jaguars, because they're jaguars in the area, and it's wild. But I don't know that would be very much to keep you from a jaguar if you wanted to get up into your place. These seem to have a lot more wood, and they use this. Now, this village had been moved. The original village was going to be inundated by Gatun Lake. And so they said, here are some areas you can go to. Pick one, and they did, and so they moved them to those areas. And I suspect they paid them as well. The said that the chief, I understood that he was 92 years old, had just died, and so this is the new chief they elect.
Oh, I was going to say.
But, just look at the painting, what they wear, and then the metal bracelets were pretty common. And they were very proud of their families. Somebody had purchased this carving. And I don't know if you probably can't see it, but there is a berry in his mouth. And that takes a pretty delicate carving to carve that and leave enough for a berry in the person's in the mouth. They were proud of their family. They said that in this place we had an interpreter so that we could ask questions. We could learn a lot more about the way they lived. And they said that it's taboo to marry within the village. So they have party with other villages, and that's where they find their mates. So again, the adornment. Let's look at both of them. You can see that the pretty nice designs. They did the upper part of the body, some didn't, and a lot to the lower part of the body. And you can see all the makeup this person did. You think the ladies here think, well, this is a lot to do their face makeup. Well, this is the whole body makeup you'd have to do. And it's probably more permanent, but anyway. And again, they wear loincloths. And I saw him running across the stones here. Wow, bare feet, of course. And his soles have to be like leather. And then I say, or not. So if you're young enough, you don't wear a loincloth necessarily, but you still get a lot of body paint, or it depends, it's an individual thing. But he's got a lot of black and red on him, and pretty delicate pattern. They served us a lunch, and the lunch was deep fat fried, you know, like we normally do. It was tilapia, and that doesn't look too good. And that's not a good picture. I don't know why that doesn't look good. But it was delicious, nice and fresh and well cooked and delicious. And then plantains, and plantains you cook. And so, but they, that was great food. The big quality baskets we've talked about before, and this is what they make them from. Now, these are all from palm leaves, fronds. And so they harvest them from particular ones. They may have to go quite a ways. But you can see that this is part of the basket design, and there's different colors. Then this is the ribbing around the basket. And if you look over here, you can see, you know, the ribbing here, and then she'll add more in as she comes to the end of that.
Wow.
And they're using this to the smaller fronds to do the weaving around the individual strands. And it's great stuff. Really great wood carvings and the beautiful baskets. Well, they told us that they had a birth soon, just before we arrived in, I don't know, weeks or whatever it was. But so now they had, their village was 115 people. And I think that's kind of typical, that the villages are maybe 100, 115 people. The one at Phineas Bay was bigger, but that, you know, it's got an airport there and it's got more commercial things going on there. And so this is part of it, of that. And you can, again, you can see how they're dressed. It was just a great experience. I was really lucky to be able to do all of this. So they have a mixed culture of their old and the new, but an awful lot of the old. Sometimes they go away to the city. They're going to take advantage of all the city has to offer. And they know the cities around. A lot of them have probably been there. But then some of them stay, and some of them decide, no, I like this simpler life, want to get back to my family, and come back. So it's a mixed bag on how they do that. So thank you very much for listening. And I would be glad to take questions or any comments that people have right here.
So what was your main purpose going there?
To catch fish. and the other, well, the last one, I was doing lectures on the Princess Cruises. Arnold?
I noticed that in your pictures, the people were very attractive people.
Yes.
And they seemed to have good teeth.
Uh-huh.
Her remote area seems kind of strange.
Right.
Did you find that kind of be universally true?
Well, I did. And they told me something when I was at the lodge. And they said that their workers come in, they want a cup of coffee. Well, they'll take a sugar, and they'll put in 4 or 5 spoonfuls of sugar. They like a lot of sugar in their coffee. And their teeth weren't very good, that they did a lot of dentistry. Now, you know, these other villages didn't have that option, and so they probably were better. But, so, yeah, I agree with you. They look good. Bob?
It seems to be a very young society.
Yes.
Did you see any old people?
We did not see old people, and I'm thinking, well, in the central, the second village, we did see some older people. Not really old. And I asked, well, how old are the oldest person in the village? And I said, you know, I got the idea it was maybe 80. But it seems to me that it's dominated by the young people. And I think that maybe on this sort of thing, as far as coming and greeting people, it was the young people that did it. There might probably some older people. I tried to count the number, 125 people in the village, and maybe half of them were there. It wasn't that we had the whole population.
Do they have any kind of an educational system for the children?
Well, they have the children. They get a full education up to 6th grade. That's within the village, and I'm showing that classroom. Then if they want to go on, they have to go to boarding schools, and the government will pay for that. So they have a pretty good education system. The government does pretty well by these people.
Cassava a couple of times.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with cassava melon, but
yeah. Okay, this is, yeah, no, not that at all.
Yeah.
And there's another taro. It's a root.
Yeah.
And it's a root that they dig up and process. When I was in Brazil, we saw them processing it, and it's there are different varieties, and some have a are toxic. You can't eat them, but they squeeze out all the juices and then toast them to take get the last of the juices out. And then they're fine. Then they're good. But it is a very hard, like a potato, only harder and probably a little bigger.
One is a cassava bee root, and the other is cassava melon.
Okay. And they're very good, and they grind it into flour, Susie, on that. You know, and so that's, they use it a lot like our flour, and there's a lot of varieties of it in the areas. Somebody back here? Yeah, Diane?
Well, looks like they don't sell a lot of shoes. Even the captain wasn't wearing shoes.
Yeah, that's right. I think there's some things you probably wouldn't want to sell, go into business there. And one of them's shoes, and one of them's window glass, and probably bras wouldn't do too well either. Well, you know, we were there after the rainy season, during the dry season, so it was tropical. It was probably in the mid-80s or something like that. And because, but it is ocean, so the temperature's moderated by that. It was, you know, it was hot, and we drank a lot of water. And
Ray, were they monogamous?
What?
Were they monogamous, or they had several?
I don't know, to tell you the truth, but I think they're monogamous. You know, I saw the family up here, and that was certainly looked like it. So I think that is the case.
The one thing I was going to say about the baskets, at least that we were familiar with in Venezuela, is that they wove their baskets so tight,
yes,
they would hold water.
Yes.
And their means of, they didn't have metal. And I don't know how many have wood implements, so the baskets used to act as pots,
right,
for carrying things as well as holding liquids.
Yeah, I should have mentioned that. That's really, you know, they'll hold water. A well-made basket will hold water. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.